So a little bit about myself. I have focused for the last couple of years on national security, the Australian Defence White Papers, other international security issues, and so that's kind of my background. Currently writing my honours thesis in counterinsurgency strategy and national security. And today we've got four extremely well-qualified panellists to be discussing the politics behind space, specifically in Australia, how that relates to our international treaties and relations, and our national security platforms. So first we've got Owen Mace. Owen Mace was part of the Australis Oscar 5 team and has graduated from the University of Melbourne with an electronics engineering degree and a PhD, and then became a lecturer in the Physics Royal Australian Air Force Department. He spent the second half of his working life in private industry and is now retired. Jason Held. Dr. Jason Held, founder of Sabre Astronautics, was a US Army major and Army Space Support Team Leader for US STRATCOM, formerly Space Command, and deployed internationally in support of military space missions. He was a lead instructor at the Inter-Service Space Fundamentals course, and he conducted flight software engineering for the Wide Field Camera 3 of the Hubble Space Telescope and testing for the International Space Station. At the University of Melbourne, he has founded Space Engineering Laboratory, provided leadership for the University CubeSat project, and Australia's first premix rocket engine. Brett Biddington. Brett Biddington owns a space and cybersecurity consulting company and is leading the delivery team for the International Astronautical Congress in Adelaide in 2017. He's director of the Institute for Regional Security, a Canberra-based think tank, and also the Space Environment Research Cooperative Research Centre, or CERC. He holds adjunct professorial appointments at the Edith Cowan and RMIT universities and was admitted as a member of the Order of Australia for services to the Australian space sector in 2012. And finally, Warwick Holmes. Warwick has worked in Europe for 29 years designing, building, testing and launching spacecraft for the European Space Agency. Warwick has built 10 different spacecraft with a total mass successfully in orbit of 37 tonnes, including scientific, Earth observation, telecoms, interplanetary exploration, global navigation systems, and manned spacecraft programs, all valued at over $1 billion. Warwick has performed 5 launch campaigns from the ESA launch base using the Ariane 3, Ariane 4, Ariane 5, and Soyuz STB rockets. Can you please welcome all of them? So the format we're going to have is a 20 to 25 minute speech from each of our panelists, followed by about 45 minutes of questions. You'll be able to submit your questions online using hashtag FFF2016, and I'll be able to receive them up here, and also through the Facebook Live feed, which I think is up now. And also, afterwards, at 5 o'clock in the Grand Buffet Hall at Union House, there'll be the gala drinks and canapes after this. Tickets are now down to $50, so please join us for that afterwards. And first up, we have Owen Mace.
Thank you. Well, I suppose I would have to be considered the sort of grandfather, the old man of this presentation. So it's certainly going to come from a historical viewpoint. But first of all, I'd like to start with a little story for you. True story, by the way. And I think it tells a very powerful story about Australians' attitudes to ourselves. Now, I'll explain why I think that's important in due course. In the early 80s, 1980s, that is, not 1880s, as you might think from me, in the early 1880s, a couple of us visited the government aircraft factory at Fisherman's Bend in Port Melbourne to look at some of their electronic systems. As we went through, we were taken into a room, and there was a sort of a tube sitting in a frame, not very impressive, but we were told that it was a hovering rocket. A hovering rocket? That's a bit silly, isn't it? I mean, don't rockets go up? Hovering? Or maybe go that way, but it does seem like a damn silly thing to do. Anyway, they told us, well, maybe not. It had been tested at Woomera Test Range in South Australia, where I live at the moment, and they successfully made it hover, move about, maintain altitude and move about. As I say, not all that useful, you'd have thought, but anyway. Well, the concept was developed despite Canberra's instructions to cancel the program, Yes, they did the testing despite being told not to. And it's now Australia's largest defence export. The Nauka hovering rocket, which is used to seduce incoming anti-ship missiles away from a ship. Kind of handy. There have been 1,000 of them made, and they're in service in the Australian, United States and Canadian navies and the US Coast Guard. As I say, the largest, I believe, the largest defence export. It's interesting, isn't it? Government had said no, and yet it turned out to be such a great success. I think it illustrates that in those days, and I think less so now to be perfectly honest, in those days we didn't believe in ourselves. When I was young, for example, it was, and that was a long time ago, when I was young, it was felt that, I don't know, professional people had to go to England to, or as my grandmother called it, home. She was born here. We had to go home to get a broaden our experience, and many doctors, many dentists, lawyers and so on did exactly that, gained their real experience in Mother England. My father said to me, do you want to go to the university that I went to, Cambridge? I said, no, I'll come to this university, and frankly, I'm damn glad I did. So it does sadden me, though, that I've seen many missed opportunities through my working life, and where there's been significant Australian intellectual property created. I used to keep a list of such projects or such intellectual property, if you like, since lost in retirement. And it was a pretty sad tale of dozens, literally dozens of major projects. So what I do is ask people, who's the Australian manufacturer of aircraft black boxes? Can anyone name one? No. Right answer. The internet was a major contribution made by this university. I sent my first email either 1979 or 1980 from this university because the computer department were heavily engaged in the development of the internet. In fact, Australia's internet connection to the world, equals the US, was from a microvax in a building, just that white building, which is now design or something. So there are lots of intellectual property. Oh, how about ultrasound images? Australian. Photocopiers, PET scanners. And also, CSIRO did some major work in gigahertz communications in buildings. Wi-Fi, in other words. So, let's look at some of the attempts to do something with this Australian intellectual property. As an undergraduate of this university, I was a member of a team that built an amateur radio satellite called Australis Oscar 5. Now, I have to say, we were pretty naive. That's not true. We were hopelessly naive and didn't know that you couldn't do these sorts of things. It just could not be done. So we did. And some of the things we did were pretty outrageous. Launching balloons from the physics building, which is not there, no, it's a different building now, the Civil Aviation Authority. We did have presence of mind to wait for aircraft to pass through. Essendon was the airport then. So we did that until the Civil Aviation Authority, whatever they were called, called us one day and suggested that we might like to launch our balloons outside of protected airspace, so we did. So that was, for me, a really exciting time. At about the same time, the Weapons Research Establishment, now the Defence Science and Technology Group, I think it's called these days, built the RESAT, which was launched from Woomera. I was involved in quite a number of semi-space projects on using large scientific balloons, and at one time we held the altitude record, 48 kilometres, and the duration record, something like 2 weeks. These are not small payloads, by the way. I don't think that they're a little payload. These are a couple of hundred kilos and more. It was an Australian that co-invented the long-track scanning radiometer instrument, which measures particularly sea surface temperatures. And so that gives, if you can do that over the entire Earth, gives a good measure of the heat balance of the Earth and temperature. Kind of useful now in these days of that climate change has been discovered. An Aussie did that. Likewise, a CSIRO scientist invented the atmospheric oxygen pressure sensor, which measured surface pressure from space. The interesting thing about that was that I knew them both while I was studying, doing my PhD just behind here in what's now the Sydney Meyer Arts Centre. Ian Potter Arts Centre. Space is an interesting place because one of the things I did when I was working in private industry was to suggest that maybe we in Australia could produce the laser retroreflectors on then on the OSAT second generation communication satellites. So indeed we had a very, very clever, very experienced, very skilled optical man by the name of Bill James, lived in Melbourne, made these incredibly accurate corner reflectors that flew on the satellite, on the OSAT second generation satellite. So you see, space projects carry not just the traditional things of electronics and communications and so on, but a lot more, right into optics, and really state-of-the-art optics too. I was involved with proposing an X-ray astronomical satellite. Also, while I was at this university, a colleague and I, well, government was asking for big projects, major projects that we Australia could do, complete successfully, and show the world what we were capable of. We didn't propose one, we proposed two. One was a space tug, which was sort of in vogue then, and the idea was that it would autonomously go and pick up a satellite, bring it back to shuttle or make it burn up or whatever was required. The other was something you may have heard of, the Cape York launch site. So unfortunately, nothing came of either, other than a lot of hot air and consultants' reports on the Cape York launch site. Never mind. FEDSAT is a fairly recent satellite that was built by CSIRO and universities. And at the time I was on the board of the board of management of the, I was actually chairman of the Institute for Telecommunications Research, which was responsible for the, in South Australia, University of South Australia, which was responsible for the communications. More on that in a bit. In something like 15 years ago, NASA came to Australia suggesting that we might like to pay for an astronaut to fly on space shuttle. As an incentive, a little bit of a carrot, they were offering us, Australia, to design and build and supply the cabin lighting for the crew vehicle to go up to the space station. Not very exciting, you might think. Lighting, boring, who cares? Well, no, this was early days of LED lighting, early days indeed. So if we'd picked that up and we'd made an industry out of that, Australia could have been supplying lighting to every modern airliner. Every modern airliner. Now that's slightly more than just a few LEDs, clever LEDs in a capsule. I was also, for my manifold sins, and manifold they were, a member of the, have to read it I'm afraid, International Space Advisory Committee of the Department of Industry, Science and Technology, that advised the Department of Industry, Science and Technology and the Prime Minister on a putative space program. A considerable amount of econometric work or data was put together to show that it would benefit the country, but it didn't happen, as we know. We played host to numerous NASA and ESA tracking stations, and that will have resulted, has resulted in numbers of Australians, might even have been me at one stage, gaining experience in very fancy electronics, communications and so on. So to me, these are lost opportunities. And in many respects, it's not just a space industry that we've not built up, but it's other industries that are of comparable complexity, need for development of intellectual property that can then be used to further develop the industry. We don't have an electronics industry to speak of in this country. We were, at one stage, National Semiconductor was still around, but they're a major microelectronic, absolutely premium microelectronics company. And they offered to put in a microelectronics fabrication plant in Australia, which at that stage was the only continent in the world without such a plant. It didn't go ahead. Aircraft, government aircraft factory, designed a wonderful aircraft, the Nomad. It certainly had a lot of unique features and state-of-the-art features about it. I think I've got time. I was at Avalon Airfield one time, and we're going out to see a test flight of the Nomad, and going out on the runway following the aircraft. And there's a plant upfield next to the in the grass next to the bitumen, the runway. And I said to our host, "What on earth is that?" You said, "That's dangerous, having a plant upfield next to the runway, isn't it? A plane might go into it." "No," he casually answered, "that's where we test the rough field landing and takeoff of Nomad." Making the point that it was really quite a unique aircraft in its day. It was built to Australian conditions, of course. Short takeoff and landing, rough field aircraft with some unique aeronautical features, which I won't bore you with. So what about other countries, countries that we might compare ourselves with? Canada's is a comparable country, I would suggest. Yes, bigger population, 50% bigger or close thereabouts. But think about it, it's got lots of unusable space. It's not quite desert, but a country with population centres like Australia. Well, Canada has Bombardier, which is the largest, third or fourth largest aircraft manufacturer, civil aircraft manufacturer in the world. Yes, it has a space program, about $300 million Canadian a year. Bombardier, by the way, Bombardier also makes trains, and it exports trains to, one guess, Australia. They also export to Europe, high-speed trains to Europe. Brazil is another interesting country, perhaps less like Australia, but its middle classes are about the same size. And it has a company which vies with Bombardier for the third, fourth largest civil aviation company. Embraer makes aircraft, which sells to, yes, Australia. And it also has a space industry and launches its own satellites. So, and if you look up on Ask Mrs. Google, she will tell you that about 70 countries have space agencies. 70 countries have space. We're not one of them. So why is it? Well, here's my personal opinion. First, as I started saying, I don't think that Australians in general, and I'm talking from experience in proposing projects to government at all levels, federal, state and local. Governments in Australia don't trust us to develop new stuff. Far better than we say, oh look, we'll pluck something out of the US, pluck something out of Europe or wherever, and that'll do us. And not prepared to take the risk. I don't seem to have our tall poppy syndrome. And I don't think that the importance of intellectual property within this country is understood. The Nomad, the plans for the Nomad and all that intellectual property, the Nomad aircraft, is now owned by Gippsland Aero, which is owned by an Indian company. Well, let me use an example that's relevant to a South Australian, the submarines. Yes, somebody groaned, and I'm not surprised. We bought a Swedish submarine. Damn good submarine, I might say. But we didn't have the right to the intellectual property to develop it further. And so now, you may have heard, we're going to buy a French submarine. We're going to buy a French submarine that's nuclear powered, and then we'll spend 10 years fiddling with the design to turn it into a conventional submarine. Here's the conspiracy theorist coming out in me. Do you think it might actually be nuclear in the air? Never mind, don't ask that question. So, should we have a... No, surely not. Should we have a space industry? Well, here's my answer, and you guys, I'm sure, will talk to this and shoot me down, perhaps. Yes, but a space industry by itself, I don't think will succeed. I think we need the complementary industries and electronics, aviation, software, decent software industry that's doing decent things. That's not to say there aren't software companies around. I used to work for one that was 4,500 people, Australian software company. It's since been destroyed. So, you know, Sweden can do it. Think of IKEA. Think of Volvo and other companies. A friend of mine's just come back from the Volvo factory. He said it was full of robots making Volvo engines. They can do it. They're a little bit smaller than us too. So what is it that, what should we be doing? Well, I think, again, South Australia provides a good model. In the 50s, I think it was, Sir Thomas Playford, the longest serving premier of any state in the world, in any democratic state in the world, nearly 30 years, he realised the importance of industry, and of course his ideas were from the 50s and 60s, So he got the car industry going, electricity, he nationalised, and water, housing for people working in these industries. So, sure, those an oil refinery. So those industries fired and fueled South Australia for many years, 30 years, maybe more. Of course, those industries now are in, or some of them are in decline. No oil refinery, Holden's going shortly. But the thought of developing, you know, an important industry for the future, something that's going to carry us forward, create intellectual property upon which we can then build, is something that I think we should be doing. I'll finish up by saying that when I was in private industry, I reckon, as a rule of thumb, and there's background to this, but not time, as a rule of thumb, for every dollar spent on initial R&D, you would need to, in coming up with a concept, you'd spend roughly $10 on getting it to a production item, and something like $100 to get it out into the marketplace, ready to be sold in quantity or whatever in the marketplace. So my question, therefore, from that is, if that's anywhere like realistic, you've got to have the intellectual property, of course, but Mr. Canberra, Mrs. Canberra, what is more valuable? A dollar in R&D tax concession or more customers? I think most companies would say the latter. So I leave you with those thoughts. Thank you for listening to me. And I'll be interested to hear what the other guys have to say. Thank you.
Thanks, Owen. And next up, we have Jason Held.
No presentation?
I think if you just click through.
All right.
Yeah, sure. Should we through?
Close, please. I'll let you drive, because...
Is this you?
No.
Sorry.
Sweet. Yeah, there we go. Yeah, a space engineer, but I can't program my own toaster. That's what's actually happening.
That's the guy.
There you go. Okay, I guess we'll just get started, just start talking. When we talk about the space industry here in Australia, and yeah, some of you could tell I'm an American, you know, by background. The accent, yeah, has only half morphed over, you know. So I could fool people when I go to the States. They think I'm Irish, give me free beer, which is nice. But I've been here 12 years I've been here. I've been here longer than I've been anywhere else in my adult life. So I've kind of been adopted by you. I married an Aussie and I'm here. So I've listened to all the arguments that we've had in the space industry and the community, and it all tends to talk about the opportunity lost. Okay, we tend to stand up and we say, here, look, we could have done these things. I wish we had a space agency, but we don't, so let's go back to sleep. I want to change that argument a little bit. I want to talk about the space industry in terms of disruption, in terms of the opportunities of the future, and in many cases, the opportunities of the present, which many of you in this room can handle and be a part of yourselves. You don't have to wait for a government to do it. You can and you should, and you better do it. All right, because it's a decision to make. Do I be a part of this? Do I not? Do I sit back and think about it? Or do I actually do something? All right. So first of all, I said the word disruption. That's got a fairly particular term. All right. So what is a disruption? For me, a disruption is a technology which has a change on the behavior of the general population. Okay. So behavior. We're talking about the way you act here in the downstream. If you're not a space person. But if you are a space person, it changes the behavior of your purchasing patterns, which is something I think we can take advantage of right now. All right, so To do that, we have to examine what's actually happening here in Australia. So where are we at? I sat back, I thought of it. All right, so Australia, we, depending on who you talk to, it's about $3 to $5 billion per year that we spend on space stuff, right? So we do have an industry. We're spending money, a pretty reasonable chunk of money. And what is stuff? Stuff is mostly, not exclusively, but mostly data of some sort. And that data is used for one or two different categories. It's used for government, so you know, naval, firefighting, imagery, communications, things of that nature. And it's used commercially, right? So you got this national infrastructure part, and you've got the increasingly important for commercial infrastructure as well. So what are we talking about? We're talking about the growth of Internet of Things, of which Australia is one of the global leaders of it. You've got Australia, Silicon Valley, you know, Technion out of Israel. A lot of technologies in IT and web come out of these places. A lot of these technologies for Internet of Things is being used in water utilities, smart cities, mining, agriculture, all those sort of key touch phrases that if you're writing a grant here in Australia, you got to put these things because it's a part of our national requirement to use. However, if you think about it, all that money that we're spending on space stuff is all on import of goods or services from overseas. Okay? So, example, the NBN Co. Who made that satellite? Okay? Did we make it? How much of that did we make? None. All right? So, of any of the satellites that are used by Optus, which is one of the other large space systems, who makes that? Okay? So, what does that mean? We're on an agreement with the United States where if we buy one of the satellites from overseas, we don't even get the schematics. We can't use it, right? So if there's something wrong with those satellites, you have to go back to the supplier out in the States. So look, not a very good scenario for Australians, but still there's a bit of American in me. So I have to say on behalf of the United States of America, I want to thank you for your contribution to my space program. Hey! No, don't clap. No, don't clap to that. I hope this recording doesn't go back to my friends in the States. Don't tell anyone, right? Don't tell anyone. I want to be able to live here and do my craft. I want to be able to live in Australia and do my job without having to move. That's my personal goal. That's why I founded Sabre Astronautics. But look, these decisions are very conscious decisions that have been made in government levels, at commercial levels, and if you think about it tactically, for many years, they have been very sound technical decisions. Even 5 years ago, I was like, all right, I kind of understand why they're doing it, for all the reasons that it's expensive to produce and launch a satellite. You know, it's hundreds of millions of dollars. It's a major infrastructure. And let's face it, if somebody else is doing it, the insurance and the risk is on them. And if somebody else is doing it, then we could probably arrange some sort of defense collaboration arrangement, which kind of works in our favor in certain respects, right? So, you know, I'm not going to go hard on the government for the decisions they made. They were good decisions for the time they were in. But the result we all feel here at the ground level, right, and I call it the Australian space checkmate problem, right? So we have this import economy of $3 to $5 billion a year, and everything has been structured to support that economy, right? That import economy. So we give tax breaks, pretty massive tax breaks, if we import space goods from overseas. Pretty cool, huh? You two can have a dish, right? And you get a tax break for that. We got nothing for export. We got no support for export specifically for space. We got some things for export elsewhere, but for space we don't have anything. We have this regulatory structure that protects that relationship as well. And ITAR is a part of it. Yes, there's a really good need for it. If you don't know what ITAR is, it means that I, as an American citizen, if I sell my product to the wrong person in the wrong way, I get $500,000 fine and 5 years in jail, right? So it's serious. So any business in Australia working with businesses in the United States, it's all designed to send stuff out, right? In our culture, we could feel it in this very room. When we talk about our own industry here, there's that kind of feeling, we can't do it, or somebody else has to do it, somebody else, no. So all of that is kind of a result of our history. So that means we get few local suppliers, few local buyers. It's too hard a barrier to enter to become a supplier of space goods here in Australia. It's just too hard. In order for someone to buy your product, you have to actually fly it. Otherwise, they don't care. And it doesn't matter how good of a research program you have at a university, if it's not going up into space, nobody's going to want to buy it, right? So that kind of brings that circle of unlife together as well. So look, Sabre, we went to the United States, and we got a lab out in Denver. It's very small. We got a small lab in Sydney, and we went out and we started selling our wares and introducing ourselves to the or reintroduction in my case. The feedback I got was, all right, that tech looks great, but you're Australian. You don't do space. You got no space program. So I got these other companies I'm going to focus on over here. But we got exceptional brand recognition for universities. Okay? So what that means is, culturally, America has a habit of buying from Americans. Europeans have a habit of buying from the Europeans. The Australians have a habit of buying only from the Americans or the Europeans. We don't buy from ourselves, which is kind of weird, but it's true. But the universities are quite interesting because a lot of the grant structure here in Australia is not designed to put money into small businesses, designed to put money into the university, which again, sensible decision, universities are good at research. So the scenario is, if the Americans or Europeans want to play with us, we are great, ripe acquisition ground, right? So they come out here, put $30,000 into a university, you get a free PhD student, and work out an IP arrangement where they get to keep the IP, bring it back to the United States. But, God forbid, if we want to make something ourselves, now we're in competition. So that's the bad news. The good news is that the game has changed. Okay, now this should not be a surprise to anybody in this room, but just to recap, old space, right, big space, you could do a whole lot with the common commercial spacecraft. $50 million to $500 million is the cost. You could do a lot with that. But there's a whole new group of form factors called CubeSats that range in size either from this big to this big. You know, the 10 centimeter cube is called a 1U. I'm not going to harp on what it actually is. You can't do as much individually with the satellite, the CubeSat, that you can with these large spacecraft. Okay? But look at the price point. Cost $200,000 to start your own space company these days. And I'm seeing them happen all over the place, right? Think about it, $200,000. That's less than the cost of a Boost Juice franchise. All right, Boost Juice franchise is $600,000 to franchise Boost Juice, right? Yeah, you could have three of these suckers flying around. Anyways, so just by the mathematics, you would say, okay, there's an opportunity here that we could take advantage of. We could certainly do that here in Australia, and you're starting to see the early stages of what I call the democratization of space. So people are who you don't have to be rich. You could go to a bank, get a small business loan. You need a decent business plan to do that. You could get angel investment funding, and people do this. But people who are not traditionally PhDs, you know, like some of us up here who have heritage, people who love space like you do, who have an entrepreneurial spirit, maybe a hacker kind of a spirit, get some friends together and form a company. And we're seeing a lot of this happening around the world in places like London, Moscow, Tel Aviv, Silicon Valley, San Diego, Sydney, Adelaide, Melbourne. It's happening. So what are they doing? One of two things. Remember that first slide I said, what Australia spends money on? Well, seems to be that's what everybody else is spending money on as well. You've got imagery to take pictures of the Earth, and this is a spacecraft company out of California that raised about $200 million. They started small with $200,000 and then increased and, you know, showed their worth and raised, you know, more. They get about 3 to 5 meters per pixel off of this camera, all right? Which is pretty good. It's the lower end of the satellite imagery market. So not as good as what you're gonna get out of these guys, right? So you're not gonna be able to count the number of cars at Walmart from space, but you could certainly count the number of ships, all right? So you could do naval, anti-piracy, agriculture, mining, all these things we care about here. And the important bit, rapid advancement, lean manufacture for spacecraft. Assembly lining for spacecraft, very rare. Okay, there may be two or three other constellations in the world that do it. The reason why this is a new area and it's important is because if you produce 100 satellites, you can experiment in ways you haven't if you could only produce one satellite for $500 million. Okay? I talked to the team the ops team out at this company, and they tell me if they get bored and they got a new algorithm, they just try it out. I got a spare satellite. Hey, I got this thing, I'll upload it. Hey, let's try it out. That didn't quite work. So experimentation means rapid advancement of technology in a way that we haven't seen since the computer disruption. Personal computers. That's the same kind of path we're expecting. All right, and on the right, SATCOM. Now, 2 years ago, I said, all right, SATCOM, that's much harder. It's going to be a few years down the track. I was pretty much right on track with when this was going to happen. I was very wrong with this one. It's actually happening right now. I've seen two companies in Australia alone, in Adelaide alone, both of whom got their seed funding for 100 satellites to do communications for low volume bandwidth, all right? So, and look, these guys are going to make hundreds of millions of dollars with it, right? And it's pretty cool, all right? So, anyways, so that's really the sign of a disruption is you have one, an opportunity, you got a technology, you have people taking advantage of the technology that have never taken advantage of it before. I wrapped a couple of logos up on this slide, just friends of mine that I know are doing it. These are just Australians. This is only the tip of the iceberg. If your company should be on here, let me know. I apologize if it's not on here. I put this together in a minute. But the point is, this is already happening in Australia. There are at least 20 startups that are working together. Of these, these guys down here have gotten seed funding. Some of these got up here got seed funding and customers. These guys just did a very small but successful Kickstarter. So there are a lot of different ways that you can start from nothing and actually do something with it, all right? All right, so that's what I call the first bump. So a disruption happens in waves. You get a peak, and then you finish with the peak, and then you get another one when there's a new technology at the end of the day. The peak that we're in right now has not yet started. We're at the first year of what I think is a four-year curve, all right? The second one after that, I think, is going to happen anywhere from 3 years to 10 years. And this is kind of where I start looking into the looking glass a bit. And the further out you go, the more wrong you could be. So forgive me a little bit as I explore science fiction. But 3D printing is brand new. It's on the ISS. You've proven that you can do it. Astronauts have made the very first tools. But what we're seeing are the plans for very large structures for 3D printing. We're seeing technology where you could 3D print electronics, 3D print all these things. So you're looking at the potential, not to launch your own spacecraft, but to 3D print your own spacecraft straight from the ISS. All right? Which means the cost of a space mission is going to go down from $200,000 to $30,000. All right? So that means even more people can get involved. That's a friends and family round. Hey, you know, mom, dad, you know, can you give me some cash? Hey, Joe, my wife, hey, put in $5,000 here and there. And you have that in no time, and you have your business. This picture on the right is actually old news. This is from 2013. That's the first 3D printed rocket engine. And that was firing at, I don't remember how hot it was, like 3,000 degrees Kelvin. It was massive hot for 3D printing. You're talking about rapid reduction in cost for very large spacecraft components. All right. Third bump, really going out there, just having fun. You've got three different categories: mining, where you're looking at logistics, you're looking at solar sails. The first demonstration prototype was flight tested, I think it was last year. And you've got reusable launch, of course, that's much more mature, that's already running. You're talking about much greater operational freedom. So now you're not changing the satellite itself, you're changing the way you use it, right? And in particular, I'm quite excited to see this technology move forward, solar sails, because it means instead of doing an orbit and revisiting customers, you can kind of sail and hold in place and look at the same customers at the same time. Changes the way you interact with people, okay? And all right, so we're near the end of this talk. So the question I have for you is, what do we do about it? Okay. We here in Australia have things that we can do. We've had the argument in the past of we can't. Let's put it aside for a minute because the environment is now different than it was even 5 years ago. Okay. We need to build a local supply channel This needs to be done with an entrepreneurial spirit. And oh, by the way, when I say that, I have to caveat a bit with a warning. 90% of all startups fail. Okay, so if you're thinking about doing it, it's a real rough ride. Some of my friends in here are doing it, know what I'm talking about. But more importantly, we need a community, okay? A community of people who are buying and selling from each other. We need to kind of break that cycle of only going back to an outside supplier when we've got some really exciting companies that are young and scrappy and working hard out here to do it, okay? So that's why I put this out here. Buy Australian, go Dick Smith. All right. So if the government is listening to this, and I do reach out on occasion, I put some advice their way. Some things the government should do is start taxing imports. Boy, is that going to be an unpopular thing with lobbyists. 20% is probably too high. I'm adopting a model I saw in India. The Indians tax any import for software. I think we could imply the same strategy. It worked for them, it could work for us. But probably at a 5%, not 20%. We have to require local suppliers in the channel. That's definitely not happening. There's a cartel related to the top prime contractors. They're going to protect their supply channels for sure. We need to drastically simplify the launch authority. Right now, if you want to launch a spacecraft, it needs a sign off from the Minister of Innovation. And as long as you're only launching one or two satellites a year, it's not a big deal. But if you're trying to do anything at volume, like some of these companies out of Adelaide that are launching 100 at a time, that man is going to be busy. Look, a couple of funding changes we could do, obviously, changing the grant structures. Of course, I completely agree with what you said. You should be going for customers, not grants anyways. But more importantly, we got to be more customer-focused and think in terms of acquisition program for businesses and government sales. So that's really it. I put this down here just as a thought experiment, and maybe it's time for a space agency to help coordinate that. That's probably going to spark more debate than I personally can handle. But it's about time we start thinking about it. It's about time we start thinking about it. Start thinking about a space agency to handle that relationship a bit more than is handling now, because nobody really knows where to go. All right. So look, that's the conclusion, three takeaways. If you remember anything at all from this, let's go from import economy to an export economy. That's the first thing we got to do. Entrepreneurial spirit, and here's the key, fly early, fly often. If you're thinking about doing this, don't say I'm going to make a spacecraft in 4 years. Do it in a year. If it's your first spacecraft, it's a year. If it's your second or third or fourth, it's 6 months. Okay, that's the time scale you should be thinking. You should be very aggressive with that. And I want you to understand that this is an opportunity that is happening now. This disruption is happening now. It's early enough days that if we start today and band together, we can take advantage of it. If you wait, then the condition we have right now will not change. If you get involved now, it will definitely change. Because 90% of this growth for CubeSat is supposed to be in Southeast Asia, right? So that's the question for you. Are we ready to do it or are we not? That's all I got to say. Thank you very much for your time.
Thanks, Jason. And next up we have Brett. Leave.
Make this work. Just hit.
Okay. So, ladies and gents, I'm going to firstly absolutely endorse what Aaron has said about cringe and all those sort of things that we are so common talking about ourselves as a society and a culture, talk down our capabilities, unduly modest, knock down tall poppies, all that sort of stuff. Jason is also right in saying that we're at an inflection point. What I want to do though is perhaps try to explain why our story has been the way it is, taking the national security perspective on this. So it's not to disagree with what our two previous speakers, Owen especially though, talking about, grumbling about why we fail. That's part of it. But I think there's another part of the story too that we need to understand, because only when that context is in place can we really figure out how we're going to take this forward? So firstly, this slide, all of the world's major space agencies, the capital cities of the nations that have that are major space players, are not just north of the equator, which is not where that red line is, but they're north of the Tropic of Cancer, which is where the red line is. Space, historically, has been a northern hemispheric activity, and today remains so. And indeed, even if all of those small companies grab the opportunity that Jason says, and I agree with him, exists, still, space is a northern hemispheric activity, which is why Jason's absolutely right when he says, if we want to succeed in this business, we have to be thinking about export. Our market is not big enough locally to sustain what otherwise we would seek to do. Just a snapshot of who's in space today. There are about 1,300. This is 2015 data, but since then we have about 1,300 operating satellites. You can see there the breakup in the countries, the big three, and then a lot of others. And then in low Earth, medium Earth, elliptical, in geostationary orbits, so different orbits. And then what they're used for, civil, commercial, government, and military applications. And you can see here that the United States still is predominant in space. A few years ago, every dollar, about 66 cents of every dollar spent in space was spent one way and another by the United States. That now figure is coming down to about 50 cents as other nations step up their own interests and investments in satellites and in being in space. For my money, and this has certainly been the case till today, and I would argue this will remain the case for a long time to come, space is the high ground of peace and war. It has always been thus. The V2 started this, we now use it for treaty monitoring. It's linked inextricably, the way that we've developed space during the 1950s, 60s, and even use it today, with the whole question of nuclear weapons. And Australia, of course, has been part of that, and the next few slides take this a little bit further. The other point I want to make, and this picks up on something Owen said, Australia is actually a pretty big place, but with a paradox of a very small population. He says, well, Canada's like that too. I agree with that, but there is a distinction, and that is that this country is responsible for about 15% of the Earth's surface, about 12% of the Earth's oceans. Canada does not have that responsibility, and also it doesn't have to worry about the sort of contested political environment as we do, because of our place on Earth. The former NASA representative to Australia, Neil Newman, used to talk about the attraction of Australia to NASA. He said, frankly, we don't give a shit about Australia much, except that it's there, bare, and fair. And they were the three bits that gave NASA the confidence to do what it's done in Australia over many years in terms of investing in its ground stations and ground infrastructure. Radio quietness in the continent really matters, and that's of course why we are pretty good in this country, not just at investing in radio astronomy infrastructure, but then in using that infrastructure to find all sorts of things out about the far universe. The other point about our strategic geography, some of you will recognise this very famous diagram from Arthur Clarke in 1945. He realised that three satellites equidistant around Earth in the geostationary ring, providing they were supported by ground stations, could see basically all but the very, very extreme polar regions. Well, if you have ground stations in Europe, in the United States, and in Australia, they can then control satellites in geostationary or geosynchronous orbits above the equator that can see those parts of the world. And that means that in the case of Australia, there has been an absolute relationship between our strategic geography on Earth and the way that satellites work in space. So now let me go back to the end of World War II, and coming out of the end of World War II, we had the Wimmer programs. Our great and powerful friend is London and the United Kingdom. The legacy of the Wimmer programs was not much in the way of IP, although things like NALCA came out of Wimmer. Who knows about the NALCA story? Not many people at all. But by and large, this is, if you like, one of the lost opportunities. The real legacy is institutional. We had a very damaging leaks from the highest levels of the Labor government, the Chifley Labor government in the late 1940s, which led ultimately to the Petrov Royal Commission, which ultimately led to the collapse of the Labor Party and the split in the 1950s, for those people who are old enough to remember that stuff. But go back to the 1940s, the Americans realising that we had a massive breach of trust at a highest level of government, basically turned off the technology tap and said it wouldn't be turned back on until we took our own security in hand, and that led to the creation of ASIO. The other legacy, as Owen's mentioned, is our Defence Science and Technology Group, not an organisation, as the slide says. So the sort of technology transfer that could have happened perhaps didn't at the levels that we would have hoped. Today, and since the 1960s, when the Brits moved out and the Americans moved in, they were very concerned, of course, to use our radio quietness, our geostrategic position, to host some pretty important, from their point of view, ground infrastructure for ballistic missile early warning, which was the Narunga base near Woomera, and the Narunga base has now been replaced by two remote antennas. They're the two little antennas that you can see on the left-hand side of the screen at the back of the Pine Gap base in Alice Springs. And Pine Gap remains one of the most important intelligence gathering facilities in the Western world. These bases, of course, have not been without controversy. Des Ball was the author in the 1980s who really tried to explain to the Australian people what it was that these places did and do. He was considered by governments and defence organisations at the time of being somewhat traitorous for even talking about this stuff in public, but he felt that it was pretty important that Australians understood what it was that was happening on our soil and what we were supporting. And indeed, we eventually had ministers say, you know, in the event of nuclear war, Pine Gap probably would be a target, and that's something that the people of Alice Springs should have been a little concerned about. We've had a succession of defence white papers since 1987. 1985-86, Paul Dibb conducted a review of the Australian Defence Force, a soup to nuts, back to basics review. Essentially, the Defence Force that we had to that point was very much a marginally modernised force coming out of World War II. Tactically focused, no capacity for the Air Force, the Navy and the Army to work very well together, and we saw that in Vietnam, and frankly, not having thought about what it was that we wanted our Defence Force to do. Dibb wrote a report that ended up in the 1987 white paper as a pretty seminal and important document, and remains so. You can see that since then we've had six white papers, four by Labor governments, two by Liberal governments. The 2013 white paper was an absolute pie in the sky document. We were going to have the world because there was this concern of China. We have far more balanced, I think, document that was released earlier this year. Now, bear that in mind, these are the references to space and satellites, just the words in those documents. Basically, we weren't even thinking about space up until 2009 in terms of our explicit national security within the defence context. These white papers are where we sort of say all that stuff. You can see the most recent white paper, a massive jump in the numbers of the use of the word space, and almost invariably linked to the word cyberspace. So space and cyber have now been conjoined in strategic thinking in defence, and if they think a little more beyond that, this is now utterly transformational in the context of what the Defence Force has to look like in the future if it's to deal with the sorts of threats that are now foreshadowed by the use of these words. Space junk, changing tack a little, is something that concerns us all, because in the low Earth orbits, if we're not careful about how we tidy up the low Earth orbits, some of them will become unusable by 2030. So critical dependencies that we take for granted from satellites in low Earth orbits. Problem here with the CubeSats, thousands of CubeSats only adds to the confusion here. How long are they going to stay in space for? How do they get deorbited? There are a whole lot of issues yet to be resolved around the cleanliness of the space environment, or the threats to the cleanliness of the space environment. It's pretty grubby at the moment anyway, that CubeSats and small satellites represent. Some companies say, we've got it fixed, trust us. There are some rules starting to be written around these things, but it's a confused space. The Chinese didn't help the cause when in 2007 they basically conducted an anti-satellite test, which means that they fired a rocket from the ground and blew up one of their old working satellites, one of their old defunct satellites. They created a massive debris cloud. A little while later, there was a collision between Iridium working communication satellite in low Earth orbit and a defunct Russian communication satellite. And a little while later, the Americans shot down one of their own classified satellites to make the point, I think, that you could actually deorbit something without creating a huge debris field like the Chinese had done, and at the same time making sure that this pretty fancy piece of technology couldn't fall into the wrong hands. But it was all done under some sort of guise of we didn't want to have nasty hydrazine or whatever in the atmosphere. So Australia is investing in learning about space situational awareness and contributing to space situational awareness understanding, certainly in the West. In 2012, the US-Australian OSMIN talks, and in 2010 is when it started, there was a very public discussion between the two countries. They've agreed to cooperate on space situational awareness. We did the same with the Brits in 2011. And Australia, again, has some pretty unique advantages geographically to support ground-based sensors and Southern Hemisphere, south of North Asia, China especially. So we've now installed, at least the Department of Defence has, that radar that has been brought from Antigua across to Northwest Cape. And there are also a couple of space telescopes that have been put there as well. We've also been active diplomatically, but there's been a thing called the Space Code of Conduct, which is something that's lesser than treaties, but that might actually lead us to some good behaviour in space. Those talks have stalled. Russia and China in the last 2 years, Russia especially, just says niet. And there's some good reasons for that, which go back to arguments about the Ukraine and some behaviour there that we all lament. But at about that time, there was a hardening of Russian attitudes about a whole lot of stuff. And frankly, we've got to figure out how to break that intransigence to come to some common understandings in order that we can keep the space environment at least clean enough to be operationally useful. So the Space Environment Research Centre is a cooperative research centre based in Canberra. I'm the director, as I think was said earlier. And basically, electro-optic systems plus RMIT plus ANU plus some others have joined together, and the idea of this cooperative research centre is to basically at the end be in a position to fire a laser at a piece of space junk, so something that is uncontrolled but where we know where it is with exquisite precision, and then use laser pressure from the ground to move that object just enough that it won't collide with another object. That's the end game of this CRC. And the idea of moving something is to hopefully overcome the problem that you have if you use other sorts of methods of dealing with space debris. Because basically anything that is about removal, capture, or whatever that we might think about, using nets, using spears, using your garbage truck, is my space weapon. And it's really, really difficult to distinguish between the two. And if the technology's hard, the politics only gets harder. And that's why this CRC is doing something a little different by saying, well, we're going to leave it all up there, but if we can nudge stuff around, at least for the moment, we can perhaps keep the space environment in the low Earth orbits usable until we can figure out how to perhaps behave better amongst ourselves as nation states and come to some better agreement. This policy was brought out when Julia Gillard was Prime Minister. The current government won't have a bar of it. You're not allowed to refer to it. You're not allowed to sort of the current government, the government that was current. And we'll see what happens tomorrow, I guess, but in caretaker mode today. The point I want to make about this, though, is the giggle factor. This policy is called Australia's Satellite Utilisation Policy. It went into Cabinet called the Australian Space Policy. And in Cabinet, the name was changed. Space is a dirty word in government for a whole lot of reasons that we don't have time to go into today. But in an electoral, contested political environment, can you imagine what would have happened had the Gillard government announced that we were going to have a national space policy, just as about she's losing her prime ministership, the economy has turned south after the saviour of the GFC and all that sort of stuff, the cartoonists would have had a field day. You can imagine the cartoonists putting Julia in a space suit with a big thing out the front for her nose and a big thing out the back for her bum, because that's the way the cartoonist portrayed her, rudely and crudely and all that. That's the sort of stuff that governments really fear about. Some of you have been to the Space Science Education Centre out here at Strathmore College. The number of ministers who go to that place and want to get their picture taken on the Mars surface, and their mind just says, Minister, no way, because that'll get out on social media, Minister on Mars. The only newspaper that can get away with this is the Northern Territory News. And a couple of weeks ago, seriously, a couple of weeks ago, there was an announcement made that Sea Launch might be homeported in Darwin. Let me tell you, pigs might fly, but that's another story too. But guess what? Front page of the Northern Territory News, the Chief Minister dressed up like one of the Star Wars characters from memory. I mean, hello. Welcome to the Northern Territory. The Australian space sector, tiny, however we talk about it, but opportunities to grow, as we've also had explained. They, for my money, are the enduring drivers for Australia's involvement in space. Our geography, our alliance relationships, commitment to international law, brackets when it suits us, and cost. And I think this is where Jason's right. Some of those things aren't going to go away. They're sort of things that governments worry about. What Jason's really saying is, let's just get on and do it. And actually, I think government is getting that message and is keen to try to help. We're going to have some hellishly hard arguments with us, with our government and our government with the United States about technology release. If we want to create an export industry, space technologies are very, very tightly protected under export control rules. So there are some big laws to be got through there. But they're the sorts of things that I would argue we need to start to do. And if we do start to do those things, we make good progress. My last slide, the little logo there is to remind you all that one of the reasons that I guess I'm here is that I led the bid that won us the International Astronautical Congress for Adelaide next year, which will be it's the world's largest space conference. 3,500 people will turn up, 20-odd astronauts or former astronauts, heads of space agencies. It's an opportunity, as far as I'm concerned, for the Prime Minister to make some serious announcement about space in an audience where the gigafactor doesn't apply and where he can actually start to set a roadmap for these guys to succeed. I wouldn't have put my time on the line to deal with this conference had I not felt that we could make a difference in terms of the narrative. What we've had is a disconnected, classified narrative, which I've described briefly, which has been, we've been so reluctant at the political level to talk, to even take into our confidence our own people, what we did at Woomera, what we do at Pine Gap, what we've done at Narunga. We've been so reluctant to talk about that stuff that we have a group of uninformed, unhappy, disaffected, disenfranchised people who say, why don't we have a civil and a commercial space sector? At the strategic level, as I think Jason said, government has actually made some pretty good decisions. As taxpayers, our strategic interests have been very well met with very little investment. But the times are a-changing, and the opportunities for us to take that. Thank you.
Thank you, Brett. And up last, we have Warwick.
Okay, ladies and gentlemen, thank you for coming today. I hope to present a talk which will complement those which have already been given, and that is picking up on Owen's historical stories about what Australia did many, many years ago and lamenting the fact that we lost a lot of that, those opportunities from those early days. And then picking up from what Jason said about the new paradigm in space technology and these disruptive technologies, making CubeSats to address the new generation of spacecraft engineering. And finally, what Brett was saying, and that is that Australia's had these long-term agreements, these strategic alliance policies with defence, with the United States. And what I hope to present to you today is how what I'm going to present to you is an agreement that I would like to have between Australia and the European Space Agency could encompass all of those three talks together, and I'll explain how. So, first of all, there's a picture which Brett showed of the rocket in Woomera. That picture was taken 50 years ago, and that was in fact a European rocket. And the rocket was called ELDO, called Europa, and it's made by the European Launch Development Organisation. Now, I don't know if you know, but 10 of these rockets were launched out of Woomera, and they were more than 100 tonnes each, and they're on the back of a cancelled British program called Blue Streak, but Europe then decided it wanted autonomy in its own, making its own launch vehicles, and they came out to Australia to use our facilities here for doing their early rocket development. And I'm going to show you a video here of one of the launches out of Australia's launch base here in Woomera. And this rocket weighed more than 100 tonnes. It delivered 137 tonnes of thrust. 10 of these were launched from Australia. So if we think we never had any technology or any interest in space engineering, 50 years ago, this is what we were doing. Now watch this video carefully. This is an enormous rocket made 50 years ago, launched from Australia. It uses liquid oxygen and kerosene with the fuels, quite simple. The first stage was made by the British, second stage by the French, called Coralie, and the third stage was German. And the technology in these days, this was absolutely leading technology in the world for, in this case, making rockets. Now, this is what Australia was doing 50 years ago with the Europeans. And unfortunately, at the end of this program, Australia then pulled out of what was then, this is called European Launch Development Organization, which has now become ESA. But we're the only country that has ever left ESA. ESA today has now 22 countries, and my argument today would be to try and go back and join them again, and I'll explain why. So some of the technology which ESA has, which is still, which you can see here in Australia today, is this is one example of how, I think Kerry was giving examples of the spin-offs in the space industry. Well, the solar cells made from ESA have won more of the solar cell car challenges than any other international team. And that is, there's been five races, won five out of 13 races in the last 28 years. And they're using the triple junction gallium arsenide solar cells, which we use on the Rosetta program. And I think with the MPP2, which is the maximum power point tracker, which is, gives you the most efficient transfer of solar power into mechanical energy electrically on, for the wheels. This car went top speed at 160 kilometres an hour. Because of this, they had to impose a speed limit. Because it was going so fast, that people would start getting killed. So I think the speed limit now is 120 kilometres an hour, respecting the road rules. But they've had other engineering factors put in to make them safer. And you see here the ESA logo because of the solar cells. Today, ESA is still in Australia. We've got ground tracking stations. This big one on the right was the dedicated ground station made for the Rosetta mission, 35-metre diameter. Another smaller one, which is now used for tracking the Ariane 5 launch vehicles as they're coming out of French Guiana. And this is $60 million to build. This is now $85 million in real terms. It was built by a Canadian company in Australia. So why are the Canadians building ESA telescopes, ESA hardware, in Australia? Now, the reason is, I'll get back to that, sorry. So, the introduction, you heard that I'd worked for ESA for 29 years, on 29 years building ESA missions. And the question is, well, what's it like to work for ESA? Well, this is a video that was made for me. It was actually a present that was given to me by one of the German engineers I was managing on the X-ray multi-mirror mission. So, Owen was mentioning that Australia made an X-ray telescope. Well, ESA then went off and made one. And this is a video showing the work that I was doing in ESA. And he liked making videos, this guy. So he actually made this for me as a present for when I finished, which I'm very grateful for. Now, this was done, started 22 years ago, so I'm going to have to point to me in the video because he won't recognize me because I'm so old. Right? So these are just all the different things involved in us making the X-ray multi-mirror mission telescope. So it's very tall, it's 11 metres high. This is me here. Now that's an Australian doing here, working for the European Space Agency. Here again, these are the questions I want you to ask yourself and say that this work that I'm doing 22 years ago, any Australian engineer could be doing today if we were then to become an associate member. So this is in the plane room in Holland, where we made the spacecraft. And this is me connecting up with the connectors for a test on the spacecraft. This is a solar ray deployment test. This is me with all the connectors. So I was an electrical test engineer and thought of it with the avionic system. Okay, so we need scaffolding to get around the spacecraft that was so big. Okay, so this is me holding the test connectors here. They look like fire hoses. There are thousands of electrical connections that you have to make to test the spacecraft. It's built in three parts, so there are three different tubes you have to connect together. So this is how we built the spacecraft in Holland. Okay. Once this is finished, we went down to here, Centrale Spatiale Guiana. This is the French Space Centre, where we launched all the Ariane rockets, which came then after the developments made in Australia. So this is the RN5 fairing, if you put XMM inside. This is a video along through a window in the elevator going up the side of the rocket. The whole assembly being 70 metres high. This is an evolution of the rockets that came from Woomera. Okay? Now this is me down in the launch site doing the final electrical testing of the spacecraft before launch. You can see I used to have dark hair in those days and even ponytail, but that's another story. So here I am talking to the guys in the clone room. They're doing the final electrical test before the launch. And now this is in a simulation of the countdown. Now this is a photo here, I'll just stop it here. This is at the base of the rollout mechanism where we had the platform for transferring the rocket. Whoops, sorry, no idea, something like that. Sorry, see if I can get back to that. Right, there it is. Right. Now here again, I'm at the base of the rocket. Look how big this rocket is now. After 40 years of leaving of the development that had occurred in Australia. So this is the rollout for the beginning of the launch. Now from here I had to go back quickly after the launch for a 6-hour flight to the operations centre in Darmstadt in Germany. So this is a countdown here, and off and away. Okay, so this is 1999. This was 17 years ago, this launch. The spacecraft is still operating perfectly today. And this is the launch from French Guiana, the top end of South America. Now, this is the European Space Operations Control Centre in Darmstadt, Germany. This is the control room. And this is me. I was chosen to lead the whole launch and early operations phase for this spacecraft. The question is why? What is an Australian doing sitting here leading the launch and early operations of the biggest X-ray telescope that's ever been made? Not me, it's an Australian. This is the opportunity that I got for working with the European Space Agency. Anyone in this room could do this. Look at the people congratulating me just because, okay, you do a good job and everyone gets happy. This could be anyone in this room if you're interested in space engineering, okay? So this is what I did for 29 years working with ESA. So what is ESA? ESA is an international organisation of 22 countries with a cooperating membership with Canada and these other countries, Argentina, Brazil, China, which have reciprocal arrangements for sharing technologies. ESA is not part of the European Union. People will be surprised to hear that. It's a separate, independent European organisation. So for example, the UK will stay with ESA despite Brexit because it's not the European Union. Norway and Switzerland are not in the European Union, but they are with ESA. So to call it the European Space Agency is actually a bit of a misnomer. It's an international space organisation. They've had more than 40 successful missions in the last 50 years, every single one of them using international cooperation. And a budget is about $6 billion. That's the leverage you get when you join ESA. You get $6 billion a year being spent on doing spacecraft technology. And the opportunity is shared equally, proportionally, amongst the member states. So, and the working language luckily is English for me, even though they say officially it's also French and German. In the 29 years I've worked for them, I've never ever been to a meeting which they spoke French or German. So it is in fact always English. They have about 2,000 staff, but they have industrial contracts supporting over 100,000 employees in the space industry. So why join ESA? Well, ESA's constitution guarantees a return. They actually say 100%, but in reality it turns out to be about 99% of all the contributions given to ESA come back to the member states. So if Australia was to join ESA and we gave $20 million a year to ESA, that $20 million actually comes straight back. So why give it to ESA in the first place? The whole idea of joining ESA is that we get the benefit and the leverage of 50 years of engineering experience building spacecraft and launch vehicles and whatever technology we might be interested in. So it's actually like joining a club which has got an enormous amount of engineering experience and expertise. And they just help us to build our own technology here in Australia with a one-for-one return with all the money given by the Australian government. So ESA would actually welcome Australia's membership because for three times they've actually tried to invite Australia to join. The first time was back then in 1972 when Australia pulled out of ESA when we finished the launch campaign testing. And there's been two other occasions as well. When I'm promoting a membership with ESA, with Australia, I am not talking about astronauts or building the ISS, or even building rockets, going to Mars or even landing on comets, because that's the high end of space. Very expensive, very glamorous, but for Australian taxpayers, our first foray into building serious spacecraft should not be doing these high-end, very exotic missions. We should be focusing on remote sensing and telecommunications, which are the more economically viable and interesting returns for Australian taxpayers. So, in the same way, I use this example here, the same way that we all know the effect the GPS has had on navigation when you're driving your car around, for example, remote sensing has an enormous improvement for the agricultural output for farmers, because from space you can measure fertilisation, irrigation, pests, water pollution, minerals, etc. So this is why building large remote sensing spacecraft with ESA would be an extremely cost-effective and have a huge value for taxpayers investing in space with an organisation that's had an enormously successful history in the last 50 years of building these kind of spacecraft. So the example I like to use, a bit like Owen did, is that Canada has been an associate member, or cooperating member state they call it now, for 37 years. So for almost four decades, the Canadians figured out that ESA is an extremely good international organisation to get involved with if you're interested in doing space engineering. Now I've listed here a whole series of similarities between Australia and Canada in terms of our GDP, in terms of the exchange rate, the economic comparisons, population densities, the fact that we're both Commonwealth countries, same democratic parliamentary system, even our demographies, this average age, income distributions, everything here in Australia is very, very similar to Canada, except that Canada is a large cold country and Australia is a large hot country. And that's effectively the only difference. Now, they also have to be very careful with their strategic and military agreements with the United States. They have an 8,000 kilometre border with the United States. So there's no other country in the world that has to be more nervous of not upsetting the Americans militarily than Canada. And that's the same thing with Australia as well. We have to respect, we've got these ANZUS alliance and these defence agreements with the Americans, and they give us a lot of data associated with Pine Gap. ESA has got nothing to do with that. ESA is a civilian space agency, and we're only interested in developing applications and spacecraft for the good of civilian use and civilian applications. And I say at the very end here, the most frustrating thing for me is that Australia has refused three times invitations from ESA to join their organisation. We're the only country that has ever, ever, ever been invited to join ESA, which is unusual because normally countries are banging on the door to join the European Space Agency, particularly Argentina, Brazil and Israel. But they've been blocked for political reasons, which I won't go into, but that's just, ESA's just said no. But they would like to join, Australia to join, but we have said no three times. So what does Canada get from ESA? Now, this is an economic discussion because, you know, what does it cost for Australia to join ESA? Well, Canada has almost exactly the same GDP as Australia. And so this is a perfect reference because the contributions that you make to ESA are based on your GDP. There's an option, there are two ways you can join ESA. One is the mandatory payment, one is the optional payment. Mandatory is the bare minimum you have to pay, which is $5 million in the case of Canada, which would then be $5 million in the case of Australia. And for that, the mandatory programs are you have to spend that money in space science, because ESA is formed from two organisations, European Launch Development Organisation and the European Space Research Organisation. And because of that original scientific origin of ESA, they insist now that the bare minimum that you do if you want to join their organisation is you must put the mandatory funding into space science. The optional program is that if you're happy with ESA, you can put a bit more money and you can get to do other things which you elect to choose to do. In the case of Canada, they've put 38% extra money into Earth observation and 38% into satellite communications. I think this is a perfect model for Australia as well, in that, again, going back to those examples of what space applications give us the most bang for the buck? Well, it's looking at farming, optimising our agriculture, our major primary industry, and communications, when you look at things like NBN Co and Optus and OSSAT. Then the space science. Now, space science involves other programs which the most famously are things like Rosetta for the and all the interplanetary science projects as well. Now, what's missing from here is any administration cost. Well, that's the good news with ESA, is that there is no administration cost with ESA, because the commercial spin-offs that they've made from their developments in Eutelsat and Eumetsat, which is a weather monitoring company and a telecommunications company, together with some money which they also get from the European Union, that pays for the administration costs. So there is every dollar we give to ESA goes straight into space technology back here in Australia, with the leverage and all the experience of all the success they've had in the last 50 years. And the final economic argument too is that three independent Canadian university economic studies from three different universities, McGill, one in Quebec, and I think, forget the third one, have said that they've all come up with this same figure, that for every dollar that Canada has given to ESA, there's been a $3.50 benefit in terms of licensing, products, intellectual property, just the economic feedback has this 3.5% multiplier from specifically the Canadian investment with ESA. And that too, I mean, that's a simple economic fact. It's not a projection that I'd like to say to you today, if Australia joins ESA, then we could get $3.50 back. Canada right now, for 37 years, as I've been speaking, has been getting $3.50 back for every dollar they've invested. So there's no economic argument not to join ESA. I'm using the example of $20 million a year because Canada puts in a bit more electively, as you can see in the optional programs. I think a good starting figure for Australia would be $20 million, and we would get to do the same work that they do in Earth observation and satellite communications and get all the advantage of all the experience they've had for 50 years. So here's just another example. 1988, an Australian engineer is working in Canada on an ESA satellite. Why? Well, the Australian engineer was me, but it could be anyone in this room who wants to do engineering. This is a telecommunications satellite, the biggest one that was made in the world at its time. It was the largest civilian telecommunications satellite called Olympus. And I'm in each of these stupid pictures. This is, again, just from my photo album. But V-32 was the last Ariane 3 rocket that was launched from French Guiana. So this is a long, long time ago. This is, you know, almost 30 years ago. This is the kind of engineering that was going on in ESA 30 years ago, okay? Now here again, this is a photograph looking at the front. Again, 1988, an Australian engineer helped to design, build, test and launch this ESA telecommunications satellite in Canada. Because this is an example of where the offset of the technology and the work, because Canada was a member of ESA, this spacecraft was built and tested in Canada. And I worked over there for 2.5 years. I then went down to French Guiana and did the first launch campaign. So, you know, why? Why am I doing this? Why is an Australian working in Canada, building a spacecraft like this? 27 years later, here's another example. This is not ESA. This is the SkyMuster NBN Co. spacecraft. 6 tons, built entirely by Loral Space and Systems in America. Not 1 milligram of this spacecraft ever touched Australian soil. It got launched by the Europeans using an Ariane 5 from French Guiana. Not a single Australian was involved in the design, building and testing and launch of this rocket, of this spacecraft. Why? 27 years ago, I was doing this one, but today Australia is doing nothing on a spacecraft like this. This is the modern version of that, okay? Now, the worst part of this story, too, is that this spacecraft shared a launch with a satellite called ARSAT, which was an Argentinian satellite, which weighed 3 tons, about half the size of this one. The difference with ARSAT was that it was entirely built and designed and tested in Argentina. Argentina, a third world country in terms of its economics. And yet they had the technology to build a 3-ton telecommunications satellite, and it's now being operated entirely by their own people, launched by the Europeans. Yet today, this, together with all the AusSat spacecraft, all the Optus spacecraft, no Australians have ever been involved in design, building and testing and launching of these things because they are the intellectual property of the companies who make them. There's the ITAR restrictions that Jason mentioned. And the only Australian engineering involvement is in specification. We say what we want very precisely, but the building and the intellectual property and the experience is all American in the case of the telecommunications satellites for Australia. This is the kind of work that we could be doing in Europe with ESA and getting first-hand direct experience of how to build this kind of spacecraft, like the Argentinian satellite, in Australia. Okay, so what is Australia doing today? Well, these are the future spacecraft, which are currently defined, that are going to be built in Australia in the next year or two. And all of them are nanosats, or CubeSats, which we've heard a few things about today. So this, unfortunately, is the scale of spacecraft engineering that Australia is doing on its own. Nothing wrong with CubeSats. They're very small. And they're very capable for the volume which they have. But this is the tiny end of spacecraft engineering. And it's been done principally by universities. Now, universities generally don't build spacecraft. In the same way, when you want an operation, you don't go to a university to have an operation. You go to a hospital. The doctor who was trained in the university, but you go to the hospital. If you want a lawyer, you don't go to a university, you go to a chambers. Despite the fact that lawyers and doctors are trained in universities, you don't go to those universities to speak to a lawyer or have an operation. But for spacecraft engineering, for some reason, in Australia, we think only universities build spacecraft. That's not true. Industry builds spacecraft. And that's what ESA is all about, is developing space industries in the countries, that join their organisation. And every new member of ESA has had ESA come in and help set up the engineering, the standards, the technology for helping to build their spacecraft. So there's been an example too that we've tried before building small satellites in Australia. And these are three examples which were much larger than the CubeSats I mentioned on the previous slide. Unfortunately, they all got cancelled. And this is another problem with small spacecraft, is that they're very easy to cancel. An agreement with ESA is legally binding. You have to sign up for 10 years, and you give that money in advance, it's paid each year, but you've got a legal obligation to follow through and build spacecraft, full stop. These things are so easy to cancel, and I can give you 30 spacecraft examples in Australia in the last 30 years which have been cancelled. Some of them were mentioned previously. And I have to very strongly support Brett when he said there's a crazy headline in the Northern Territory newspaper about a rocket that's going to be built there. I've got 16 reasons, technically, why that project will never, ever, ever get off the ground. But if they're involved with ESA, they would definitely find the solution. I mean, I could tell them as well, but they're not interested. So this is part of the problem, is that we don't have the experience to do these things on our own. Here's a good example. ESA in Australia. On the left, this is Miles working on the ATV, Autonomous Transfer Vehicle, which refuels the space station. On the right is a photograph that was taken just a few weeks ago of a CubeSat that's being tested in Canberra. I was working on this spacecraft on the left more than 10 years ago, okay? And it's the equivalent of a 30,000U spacecraft, okay? Now, I'm not trying to show off. I'm simply telling you fact. There's another Australian standing at the base of a massive spacecraft, right? This is not a fantasy, a fairy tale. It is fact. And this was done 12 years ago, in fact. Now, this is ESA. This is the benefit you get by joining together 22 European countries and other countries, combining $6 billion of the economic force of putting all those resources together, and you get to build spacecraft like this. As a member state, you get to see everything. You don't get just a small proportion according to what you pay for. You get to see and do everything. That was why I was managing the launch of XMM. That was why I gave this countdown to start the Rosetta mission. What the hell is an Australian doing in these kind of situations? But that's the opportunity you get with ESA, okay? For $20 million a year. So I'm pushing this hard because I've now left ESA. I have no benefit. I've done it all. I think there's a lot of people in this room who are very interested in space, would love to do things. Well, I left Australia for 29 years and I had to do it over in Europe. If we join ESA as an associate member, the work is done here in Australia. That's the way it works. That's why all the Canadian work was done in Canada. That's why I went to Canada. It was because it was an ESA project done in Canada. Here's an example of the electronics of a CubeSat on the right and the electronics of ATV on the left. This is what I worked on for 4 years, testing the software and building the hardware of this avionics bay. The question is, how big is it? Well, it's that big. That's the second bay. There are actually two of them. I lied. There are two bays of electronics. Compare the size of that, the complexity. Every single box of electronics is several times larger than the entire CubeSat. Okay? There's ATV in space. We made six of them. Not just one. We made six. We supplied the space station with food, water, oxygen, fuel, scientific equipment, and it did the orbit corrections. This module is used for lifting the entire space station. It's got a 4-ton thrust on its engines. On the right, for the same period, poor old Australia, nothing. They're still building those CubeSats, nothing has yet been launched. No, again, I'm not trying to rub it in, but it's a fact. It's an absolute pure fact, I'm telling you. Okay, here's another example. XMM, this is the video that you saw. Australia made FedSat back in 2002. And it was actually made by the platform was made by an English company called Space Innovations Limited that luckily went bankrupt. And the final building of the spacecraft was actually completed in Australia, together with integration of the six payload instruments that were made. So we actually did some fantastic work on this small, this is a mini satellite. It was about 60 centimetres cubed. Yeah? And on the left is XMM. So there's a comparison of the number of scientific papers. Okay? 700 times as many PhDs have come out of XMM. More than 3,000 times of the citation references and reads have come out of XMM. Yet, XMM cost 25 times FedSat. So for 25 times, you get 700 to 3,000 times the throughput. Rosetta, okay, again, there's another story. Don't have much time, I'm afraid. But I was an avionics system engineer that worked on that for 4.5 years and has now landed on the comet successfully. And so with Australia, I'm sorry, there's no comparison that I can think of. Okay, so the final story is ESA in Australia equals technical innovation, remote sensing, Earth observation, telecommunications, everything that we want to do. It's not rocket science, but it is time to catch up. And this is the message I want to leave you with today as to why I think Australia should become an associate member state of ESA for $20 million a year. And that's the end. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Warwick. And we'll go into Q&A now. Remember, if you want to send in a question, you can go on Twitter and hashtag FFF2016, and then, or you can go onto Facebook and there should be a live stream. Just get the mic on. Your first question here.
Testing. My name's Richard Tonkin. I'm with Alan Nice, who was the first presenter this afternoon, built the first satellite in Australia. We called it Australis, and it was an amateur radio satellite. It was launched by NASA in 1970. After that happened, none of us who were in our early 20s were able to go into space industry in Australia because there wasn't one. My children weren't able to go into the space industry in Australia because there wasn't one. And I now have grandchildren, and I hope that they can. I'm now an old man. I walk with a stick, and I sincerely hope that that my grandchildren may be able to participate in the Australian space program. Now, my question, after all that, is to Bruce. Bruce, can you think of any reason why we shouldn't join ESA? I'm sorry, Brett.
There are actually a lot of reasons why we shouldn't join ESA. Let me put on two hats. Let me sort of be the government hat for the moment. The government will be reluctant to join ESA because it's not the United States. And our alliance is with the United States, and space stuff is done with the United States, not with Europe, and we don't trust the French. And Brexit and all that actually doesn't help. Warwick's point is right. ESA is not going to be affected in quite the same way as the EU, but there's been a huge fight brewing in Europe behind the scenes about who controls space in Europe. Between the EU and ESA, and the two ways that's been set up politically. And the EU is falling apart. It's going to take a decade, but it's falling apart. And I think, so with my government hat on and thinking about what I've just said, ESA is no longer a very good investment. It might have been some time previously, but I think that the government will be very, very reluctant to take this on board. The other thing is now cost, $20 million. $20 million for any science program in this country is huge. It shouldn't be, but it is. We had $40 million for the Australian Space Research Program 5 or 6 years ago. We turned that into something way beyond $46 million. The multiplier absolutely works, we know that. But ultimately I come back to strategy, politics, and say it's not gonna happen, even though the logic that is put before us makes it seem very attractive. Final point, if we join ESA, that means there has to be a space agency. You've got to ask yourself what a space agency will do. A space agency to do coordination and make friends with the world makes sense, and Australia loses out because we don't have that function as well articulated in government as we should. Unfortunately, and this comes particularly from a couple of rowdy academics, they advocate for a space agency effectively so that they don't have to compete through the ARC, the Australian Research Council grants process, on an equal playing field with peers to get money. They see actually an Australian space agency as a shortcut to grants for them, as opposed to having to have to argue against all the others who want money out of grants programs. Government is not going to allow rent-seeking behaviour to persist. If they were to shut up and turn the argument around and start talk about collaboration, start talk about innovation and change their language, that would strengthen the argument hugely. Finally, space agency, if it were to be set up, would be a small organisation, 50, 100, and small organisations, the way that we structure our bureaucracies and fund them, are exceptionally vulnerable. If the Department of Defence loses a 5% cut, they wouldn't even know. But if you take 5% of people out of any small agency, think of the War Memorial, and they had a 5% cut a few years ago, told government they'd be closing on Sunday. They were told they were given, therefore, an exception. So you've got to think about some of the really hard nut stuff here to get through this. And so I'm a pessimist. It appeals to me from my heart, but I think that the head will say that it's not going to happen, I'm afraid.
You want to give it to Warwick? Warwick, you should comment.
Okay, well, from my perspective, Australia's had this long-term agreements with the United States, with defence, with Pine Gap, this kind of thing. But having said that, so has Canada, and that's why I made the point of saying that they've got an 8,000 kilometre common border. So nobody could be more nervous of upsetting the United States in military or strategic terms.
Trump's going to build a fence.
Mr. Trump's going to build a fence. So I'd like to think that the Canadians checked with the Americans when they joined ESA. They said, listen, do you mind? And they sort of almost scoffed at them, saying, well, what are you asking us that stupid question for? Because that's a civilian agency, and it has nothing to do with what we're doing. And this is why I don't know why the Australian government is nervous about upsetting the Americans, because it's got nothing to do with any military agreements or ANZUS or Pine Gap or anything. So I don't know why the Australian government thinks like that, but for whatever reason they do it, it's simply wrong, okay? Now, as far as the space agency is concerned, that's true. ESA will only negotiate directly with a federal government space agency. To me, that's another reason why we should have one, and I think Jason had it in his slide, and there's many other people. With the politics behind how we ask for that and changing the language, I don't know, but we do need one. New Zealand has just announced they have set up their space agency, which was the last, excuse me, which was the last remaining country in the OECD. We are the only country in the 35 nations of the OECD, except for Iceland, which has 1/75th the size of our country, okay? The only country that does not have a space agency. This is Australia, yeah? Even New Zealand last week announced they have a national space agency.
You've got to then say what they're going to do, Warwick, which is do what Australia did in terms of international law and signing treaties 30 and 40 years ago. I mean, it's,
okay.
It's
but
what, a name.
But that's not a reason for us not to have a space agency. Yeah?
That's been done already, so that's not an argument to do it in its own
right. No, but I'm presenting an argument for why we need a space agency, because that means we can then engage with ESA, for example. Yeah?
Okay.
Yeah. I'll just have a very quick go at that. Perhaps there's another way. I'll make an observation that the Mars rovers have meteorological sensors on them, wind sensors, and so on and so on.
Have a guess, and some of you will know, have a guess who supplies that the MET sensors and why. The answer is that it's a company called Visala. They come from Finland.
Okay. Well, one of the things which you should know too is that there's a microprocessor chip in the Mars rovers that's actually made in Australia. It's from a company called Silana. But they sell them to the States and they get put in their hardware and we never hear from them ever again. So Australia does have this technology. I think it's just very sad that there's these tiny little companies trying to desperately get involved in space engineering. And yet if we were to join a much larger organization and who have the experience of project management and all these huge resources. I always like to use the example of, imagine if you're interested in playing golf. Now there's two ways you can play golf. You can buy 100 acres of land, you can start with $100 million. You can buy 100 acres of land, you can get lots of landscape gardeners to come in, and you can build the clubhouse. You have to do all that before you hit your first golf ball. Or you can join an existing club. And the only money you're spending is the green fees and the annual membership. Well, that's what ESA is. ESA has got this huge golf course with the Club Pro and all the facilities there, ready for you to use, and you can get straight onto the fairway and start hitting golf balls. Now, what I'm seeing in Australia today is we're trying to build the first fairways with our CubeSats. That is a very, very ineffective, inefficient, not effective way to spend taxpayers' money. But it's not even taxpayers' money in most cases. But this is what I'm saying. If the government is really, really interested in innovation, and we keep constantly hearing that from both parties, then why the hell don't they do it effectively and cost-effectively? And join an international organisation. We've got international agreements for our defence. Why don't we have it with civilian space? And I don't think we need to be nervous about the existing military agreements with the Americans. I don't believe that's any reason at all why we cannot join a civilian space agency, ESA. So I'm hogging the microphone here, but...
Let people ask questions.
It's moderating,
is it? I think that's right. Good afternoon. My name is David Broadbent. I'm a robotics engineer. I'm also a diesel mechanic by trade through the CAT organisation and Rolls-Royce trained engineer as well. Very recently, I was in Auckland working for Rocket Labs USA on their new rocket as a vehicle test engineer on the base stage. You ask, why is an Australian in New Zealand working on a rocket rather than here? The obvious answer is we don't have it. And I would say the number of Australians working on that rocket in New Zealand, I could count, not in that hand, not in both hands, but both hands and both feet, and then look for somewhere else to count them. The thing that I'm seeing is we've got technology that we had in Wamra. I was in Wamra. I've seen a lot of stuff having travelled the world. The quandary I'm seeing is, why is Australia not joining ETSA? If it's the lack of funding, I'll stick my hand up and offer you $20 million and I'll create a private group to generate that $20 million and join them as a private company to this private commercial space agency. I've got a defence clearance, I'm a defence contractor. I can't see why does it need government to actually be the one to join? Why can we not join themselves as a corporation, as a group of Australian engineers at the least?
Okay, look, there's a simple answer to that question, and that is that ESA will only deal with federal governments. And the reason they do that is to guarantee that there's long-term, legally binding agreements. If you're going to commit 10 years of funding, it's got to be there, and it's got to be bipartisan. So whichever government comes in, whether it's Liberal or Labor, they will continue to pay the $20 million a year. So this is true of most international organisations, that they only negotiate with federal governments, okay? And that's correct. So again, that's our fault for not having a federally, a single focal point for federal government space agency work, okay? $20 million a year. In Australia, we spend $30 billion on the Department of Defence. We could join ESA 1,500 times every year compared to what we spend in military money. So if the United States is worried about us joining ESA, I don't think they've got much to worry about, because it's 1,500th of our annual expenditure would be them joining fee for ESA. But to just get to answer your question, we must have a central federal government agency to negotiate with ESA.
We had a question come in off Twitter, I believe, from Lisa, who says, with an election tomorrow, is the best chance for an Australian space industry with Malcolm Turnbull, Bill Shorten, or Richard Di Natale?
It's completely irrelevant. That's the answer. The future of space in Australia is commercial. I think that's what we're getting out of this entire debate. Do we go to ESA? Do we not? Like, if we went to ESA, that'd be awesome. I'd be in both hands in the air, and I think a couple of other startups here would be as well. It doesn't matter who takes the leadership next, as far as making a decision for a space agency. I think there have been some positive overtures with the current government saying, okay, we get the sign, but the overtures are happening because the space community is actually forming,
yep.
All right? 10 years ago, there was nothing here. There was no commercial. It was exactly as Brett said it. It's like, okay, academics trying to get more money outside of an ARC research grant. Now we've got people who are trying to build stuff to make money for it, and that's self-sustaining. And the government's responding to it. I could tell you this, the state-level governments in New South Wales is 100% bullish on both sides of the aisle. I think if Liberal or Labor, I think both sides would be open to it. It's up to us as a community to take that seed that we're developing and build it up into something that the government can get behind. And then, you know, then we can have our space agency, then we could join ESA, and at least we can make an argument for it where they can say, oh, but we don't do space, but no, wait a second, we do. And then the argument, by the way, is, well, we spend $5 billion a year on other people's space programs, let's take $20 million of that and throw it into ESA or throw it into something else that makes sense.
If I can just add, perhaps my point, and I haven't given you my personal view about this, but I'm going to now, the ESA argument will get traction in 4 or 5 years' time. I think it's a little early just yet. I think there are some steps to go first. So you're right, Jason, it doesn't matter which party gets into office tomorrow, it's going to be commercially led. It's the little germs that have been running around that have led the government to review the Space Activities Act. Instead of being bashed over the head, you need a different act. Governments don't like being bashed over the head. They tend not to respond too well. But rather, there's been another group of men and women underneath just quietly saying, we'd like to do stuff, will you help us please? And remember, you're going to reduce red tape. You are stopping us from doing business while you continue this. That has resonated, and that's been a very important driver in why the Act has been currently reviewed. Government will respond, and similarly, if you come to the ESA argument, if at some point we have a bunch of large commercial institutions saying to government, you know, we can't build an innovation ecosystem without a component that has a space aspect to it, at that point, government will start to respond again. That's when I think the $20 million comes right into play, and as you point out, Warwick, it's absolutely small change.
So on the point of that, Nick asks, isn't the real issue here really about the overly prohibitive legislation? With the Space Activities Act being reviewed at the moment, our capabilities hang in the balance depending on whether any reforms can be implemented.
I would say that the Space Activities Act review, don't think of this as a negative but as a positive, and think about how we've been able, as a community that Jason's talking about, with careful and sustained, if you like, conversation with government, to move to the point that the Act is now being reviewed. Governments don't move fast. There's lots and lots of inertia. And the fact that they've even opened the door to conversation is a huge change in attitude and heart. So be optimistic about this, but also, sadly, I have to say, be patient.
And just quickly, on the point of legislation and legal barriers, Owen, what were the kind of legal and political barriers that you faced during Australis Oscar Five, aside from your balloon?
Well, a simple, straightforward answer to that is none. Yeah. but it actually isn't utterly, completely true. But near enough. We did have the support, and I don't think we'll ever know the level of support of the NASA senior scientific representative, Wilson Hunter. He supported us just tremendously, I think. And he also became a friend. In fact, he sent my wife and I a wedding present. So that just shows you the level of which we still have, by the way. It just showed the level of commitment that he had to us. The other side of the coin was that, and you'll hear tomorrow when you come to our presentation on Australis at 1 o'clock, I think it is, somebody nod at me, yeah? 1 o'clock in this room, presumably, how the US side of the whole exercise contributed wildly more than we knew, and the way that it was pushed through the NASA organisation and so on.
Yeah, we had a little pushback in the States on that.
I imagine that, but nevertheless, I'm acknowledging that it was a fantastic effort on our behalf. We'll get into that tomorrow, and we'll talk about whether the Vice President was asked to give his approval or not. But that's another question for tomorrow.
I will just notice briefly, as I just let to tell people, because I'm a little bit late. I was originally applying to be a speaker as well. I will just to say that when I'm attempting I started 3 years ago, Australian-owned space agency, which is building Australian-owned rocket. And my organization is called Space Y, because it's like inspired by the SpaceX. So it's a private company, because we can't rely on government, so we do privately everything. And also a good idea, basically, create some sort of hybrid to create the gap between the problems we have with this political lockup, basically. So what I call basically my company is as a small incumbent of this Australian Space Agency, which I take this liberty to tracking and organizing, linking all the people in Australia. And once we got this unofficial organization, then we can get a political push to get actually succeed, and government will need to recognize, because once we got this running rocket, running satellites on launch from Australia, everything is done like this way, then just government will join into it. Because like if you build a cars, for example, when you got a factory which is building cars, then we must, government just approve it. So this is good idea, which was not possible before. It's a good inspiration for all people in here, because there's people who were working for 50 years, like those banging by the head to the wall, trying to get something. So this is a very good idea, inspiration by Mr. Elon Musk, that you need to work for any stupid government, you can do it yourself.
Take the one as a comment. In the front.
Andrew Rooney, Southern FM. Two questions. How far along is electro-optic systems in their plans that you mentioned in discussion? And the satellite utilization policy, which was introduced right near the end of the Labor government, was it ever followed? And you sort of alluded to its status, but what is its status at the moment?
So I need to be clear that it's not EOS, it's the actual CRC that has the, of which EOS is a member, their end state is to be able to fire a laser to put sufficient pressure on an object in space to move it a little bit. So it's EOS. But you've got to record that correctly as the aim of the Cooperative Research Centre, and it's got three sets of research going on which lead to that final end state. With regard to the satellite utilisation policy, the Abbott and now Turnbull governments haven't disowned the policy, and they have not reviewed it, and they've been happy for it to be, if you will, the default Australian position internationally. However, they don't particularly enjoy it either because it's not theirs. So it's not that there's anything in there that's offensive to either the Abbott or to the Turnbull governments, but because it's not theirs, they don't have full ownership of it. However, if the question were asked by, in particular, an international player, what's your space policy from a civil point of view, they would use the principles in that policy without necessarily claiming ownership of it. We get very petty sometimes when we get to this sort of level, but I guess the point is, as I've been trying to say too, we don't have an articulated national narrative that, if you will, transcends bipartisanship because it's not yet that sufficiently strong, or the issue doesn't have the gravitas that perhaps we would all in this room hope it would achieve at some point. There are some points, though, to make that I think are starting to give us some optimism. There was what was called a community of interest group set up within the Trusted Information Sharing Network of the Attorney General's Department that looks at critical infrastructure in Australia. And we have basically seven critical infrastructure stovepipes: communications, energy, transport, food and agriculture, medicine, finance, and water. I think I've just got the seven. A review or a study that was done just a year ago about those seven stovepipes reveals that five of the seven have a meta dependency on secure and assured access to information from satellites. So you're beginning to see in the Commonwealth now not just interest and concern in defence, not just interest and concern in the communications department looking at spectrum, not just interest and concern in the Bureau of Meteorology, Geosciences Australia, the users. You're now beginning to see a broader conversation around our vulnerabilities and dependencies on secure and assured access to space. And that's agreed across all parties. So you're beginning to see a coalescence of interest, and you're beginning to see these sort of commentaries given more space than they were previously, given more airtime. We need to think really carefully, and we haven't talked about this, the concept of dual use technologies. You know, I mentioned quickly that my space weapon can be your garbage truck, but that's a sort of a glib way of saying that. We need to think really, really, and of course this has impacts for our exports, because these are sensitive technologies, and so you've got to sort of be assured that if we want to export a space widget that we've developed in Australia, it doesn't have any ITAR restriction on it. And even if it doesn't have an ITAR restriction on it, it still may have some technology in there that the Australian government determines that we do not want to share more broadly with the open market. So this is hard stuff. And to come to the question up the back about, well, you know, engineers and technicians, that's part of the solution only. If we're going to build an innovation ecosystem in this country, and this is why I salute actually what's happening here at Melbourne University, the people who put this conference together, there are lawyers, there are economic students, there are people around the engineers who are realised, because the engineers have realised they cannot do this themselves, that you've got to build effectively, just like any business, a whole lot of other helpers to bring you into the fold. And this is where Warwick is saying,
let's not build the bloody golf course, but let's actually start to play on the fairways. And I think that's a great thing to do. As I've said, personal view, I think the time is not quite ripe yet, but if we seed this properly, that's where you can then bring this through and have the Prime Minister, maybe next year at our space conference, make exactly that sort of announcement. But it's a way of getting there that doesn't scare the horses. That's what I'm interested in.
Just regarding the ITAR issue that Brett just mentioned, one of the good points with ESA is that there are no ITAR restrictions. So everything there is shared. Intellectual property, same thing. Is that, you know, you don't join ESA if you're going to try and hide things. It's all about sharing technology. So we are not constrained with those problems either. My greatest regret is that Australia was the fifth member of ESA in those days back in 1964. ESA, ELDO, European Launch Development Organisation, which has now become ESA. We were a member of that organisation and we left it. And this is the thing that drives me crazy. Look at the size of those rockets who are being launched out of Woomera 50 years ago, and today we're scrambling to make CubeSats and to make any kind of space technology at all. This is just so wrong in so many levels, because we were one of the first members of ESA. And now we're begging you to get us back in again. Look what I've done. I've done all that. I've finished. I've had enough. I'm back in Australia now. I've finished my engineering after 29 years. And I think it's very sad that I've been spoiled rotten by the opportunities I've had as an Australian engineer who wanted to do space by ESA. Now, the one thing I forgot to mention to you is I have a British passport, and that's the only reason I could work with ESA. That's the only reason, okay? So I'm cheating a bit. But I'm an Australian. I did 24 years of my education in this country. Also, my first 24 years was high school, primary school, university. I went to Sydney University. And then my very, very first job was over in Europe. And for 29 years, once I got there, I never came back. It was so interesting. Why?
But that's the point. You have to be a European citizen.
Or
a member of a country that is associated or joined.
Correct. Right. And that's why I want Australia to join ESA. Like Canada. Canada is not Europe, okay? No, Canada is an associate member.
A bit earlier you said anybody in this room can be a member.
As Australians. You're all Australians here, aren't you?
But wait a minute. The catch is we have to persuade the government to join ESA for that to be able to.
Yeah, whoa, okay.
You haven't quite made that clear.
All right, okay. If Australia joins ESA, then anyone in this room could know. Two points. A, the capability. I was an Australian engineer, educated here, okay, and I could make it. You saw the level that I got to within ESA, okay? And that's just because I was a good engineer and I was very keen, okay? But also, I had a British passport, okay? Now, if Australia joins ESA, then anyone in this room can join, okay? I thought that was obvious, but okay. So this is why I'm trying to encourage Australia's government to join ESA, okay?
There's a question over there.
Hi, thanks. My name's Sebastian, and I'm one of the only companies to have actually gotten approved to fly an Australian-made object into space, the other being Optus, and I'm from CubeRider. And I think this whole ESA conversation is a bit of a pipe dream, personally. What I think I would really like to ask you guys is, what's the role of venture capital and private investment in the space industry? I mean, you see it in Silicon Valley, you see it in the US now, and you see it in Europe as well, where there's hundreds of, literally billions of dollars being invested in small space startup companies, and then they're going off and doing massive big things and disrupting traditional players like Globalstar satellite imaging and stuff like that. And yeah, I'd just like to hear your opinions.
Yeah, okay. I think you've hit the nail on the head. We're talking apples and oranges. Okay, so on one hand, having a space agency, ESA, all that has certain benefits that's already been discussed. Whether it happens or not is immaterial because the disruption's happening today, right? So, you got to fly to the ISS, you know, all those systems, you got hardware going up with you guys up there. I think that's awesome. That's exactly the type of stuff that is happening completely independently of any political party. So the role of venture capital, that's a huge question. I'm not going to dig too deeply into it, but venture capital is already being spent on space. Their investors in Australia are looking at it as well. They've taken some time to get on board. I think culturally in Australia, we have this thing where I like to say, comparing Australians and Americans, Australians are pioneers, not explorers. Americans are explorers a little bit more so than pioneers. And what I mean by that is Americans will look for something brand new nobody else has done before and be like, wow, let's try something brand new and take that risk. Australians are more cautious, okay? It's like, all right, you've done that before, but oh, kind of like a wedge. You see something that's successful, even a little bit, and you build something brand new. Rocket Labs, great example, New Zealand company built by Australians, all, you know, primarily. I've had a lot of students that go there. Planet Labs, who's got some competitors in this room, they opened a door proving that you could sell using imagery, mass market. They raised $200 million. Their CTO is Australian. The whole point is they moved overseas and did it. They could have done it here. I'm not going to argue about the rocket, but certainly they could have done it here. Okay, any satellite manufacturing can be done here and attempted. That is what we're seeing. A disruption means that it's not, we don't have a choice. The government is actually, and this is back to that question before, the government is now scrambling to respond to the market condition, all right? So it's up to us to show the government the way, and they're coming to us. They're saying, I don't know what to do with these CubeSats. Are they useful? Are they, well, yeah, they're useful, you know, I mean, 3 to 5 meters per pixel. You could do naval warfare with that. You could do anti-piracy. You could do agriculture, mining, all these things you care about. Great. Okay, is there still a role for big space? Sure, 1 meter per pixel, sub-millimeter, yeah, there's a whole lot more you're going to do with that. But the technology is changing so rapidly with the CubeSats that everyone's a scramble, okay? So the role of government should be to produce regulation that makes it easier to be a part of that story, okay? It should be, and I think there's a lot of mechanisms talking about innovation and the story on innovation that's actually happening that they are listening to on both sides of the political aisle that I think is very much in your favor, in your favor. You're all gonna win, okay? The point is you have to start now. That's the point.
I think there is another role for government, and that is to be the customer. That was my point I was trying to make before. And yes, it's going to have to take a risk. And yes, sorry, Mr. Government Project Manager, you're going to end up with a project that fails everyone. So sorry about that. But it's going to happen. But then there are going to be the wild-ass success stories that you know, just make it all worthwhile. And I think that's the point I was trying to make, that we're too scared to take... And this is a cultural thing. It's a cultural thing that comes from way back when. Even before I was born, if you can believe that. It's a cultural thing that we don't sort of believe we can do it. We don't trust that we can do it. And I've just seen that so many times in my career. And, you know, the biggest buyer in Australia is government.
And ladies and gents, just yesterday in the morning, Deloitte has been taken on board by the industry department to try to understand what the cyber security growth centre is going to look like in Australia. Now, the problem is growth centres are meant to be industry-led. So how can you have a cyber security industry-led growth centre if you don't have any cyber security industry? Do you see the parallel with what we've been talking about today? And exactly the same point was made by a very successful startup. It was M5 Networks, bought by Northrop Grumman, and now the guys, having sold that, have gone back to the start and they're starting another startup. And they said, we don't care about the government grants, just give us a purchase order.
Yes.
Because with the purchase order, I can then go overseas and sell and say to answer that very first question, but who in your country has bought your product? So that point you could see Doug Elix and Adrian Turner, the two guys who are running this Cyber Growth Centre, writing furiously, let alone the bureaucrats in the back from the Department of Industry. Now, whether we can crack something that we haven't cracked for 250 years,
jury's out, but we've got to keep hammering at this. Just ask, don't ask for grants, ask for purchase orders, all you entrepreneurs, and see how we go. All right?
Yeah. We've just hit 5 o'clock, it kind of crept up on me, and so I'd like everyone to join me in thanking our panelists for their time this afternoon. And I look forward to seeing all of you at the gala in Union House now. Thank you.
Here are some handouts about the conference in Adelaide next year. If anybody wants one, dates and so on, they're always helpful.
Oh,
thank you
very much. I didn't have to do a whole lot, but
it was excellent. It was actually so much fun doing all the research.
Yeah, I know.
I just get stuck. Because when you first came, so I'll follow the conversation.
Yeah.